Mr. Robert Ackerman.
Cool, thank you.
Thank you.
I love having these conversations. I love the Q&A. You know, I'm really here to be a resource for you. So if, you know, if you got a question, don't be shy. It doesn't have to be related to security. It could be related to, you know, how do you raise venture capital? I teach new venture finance at Berkeley in the MBA program. And, you know, I've got this great joke that the faculty thinks I'm teaching a finance class. It's actually a marketing class, because raising venture capital is a marketing problem. It is not a finance problem. So we'll go anywhere you want to go. You know, a little bit on my background. So once upon a time, I was an engineer, kind of one of those early computer science guys at that cusp of the transition from computer science residing within mathematics to being in its own function. I'm a Silicon Valley guy, have been my entire career. Built a couple of companies. First company I built was a company called Unisoft, which was one of the two major Unix systems houses in the world. A group of us were known as the Unix Mafia. In those days, you know, we all came out of the deep dark, you know, UC Berkeley computer science BSD program, and you know, we did a lot of things around open systems. The very early open systems initiatives came out of that Unix community. I started another company called InfoGear Technology Corporation that actually kind of got revisited this year. There was a podcast, a guy that does the history of the internet. Did a podcast on the original iPhone. The original iPhone was the product that we created, InfoGear. So it was the vision around the original integration of web and telephony. And that core patent, we actually have that core patent, it now resides at Cisco. So it was funny when that podcast came out this week to kind of walk down and look a little bit of history. I started Allegiance Capital almost 20 years ago. And really out of frustration with the venture community. We were just talking about, if you go back a couple years ago, the venture community would tell you that they wouldn't invest in hardware. So if you imagine I'm running this company called Unisoft, I'm looking to raise capital, and I've been in the workstation business. I put Unix on workstations for the first time we ever got it off a mini computer. And my friends at Sequoia Capital, when I was running this company, said, you know, Bob, we really love you, but the software company thing, you know, the assets all have legs. They go home at night, and it's like, what did you just say? It's like, you know, a bunch of hardware that's work in process in a warehouse someplace makes you sleep at night. You know, it's all about people. And right there, I said, you know, as much as I like my buddies at Sequoia, you know, the venture community is not as plugged into innovation as perhaps it could be. And my point was that, have you looked at the operating margins? Have you looked at the leverage? I mean, it's a much better business than the hardware business. And so at that point in time, you know, as a first-time CEO raising capital, being rebuffed by the venture community, my obvious conclusion was, it's not me, it's them. And one day I will teach them. And that really led to the founding of Allegiance Capital. Today, we're an early-stage venture capital firm. So I say we like to invest in two guys and a dog in a garage with a big idea of how to change the world. So we're early stage. My team are all ex-operating executives. We have, over the years, we've done a variety of things. But I think historically what we've been best at and what we've probably enjoyed most is security. So over the last couple of years, we've really sort of turned hard into security. So that includes cybersecurity and sort of related technologies that have a big impact or require security. So we do a lot of data analytics. We've been doing data analytics for 20 plus years. Internet of Things, before there was an Internet of Things, we've been in that space for about 10 years. And then we do a fair amount of virtualization. If you draw a Venn diagram of those things, you'll find there's a lot of intersection between those areas. And that's where we tend to focus. I've been involved in cybersecurity for, in a pure sense, about 15 years. If you throw privacy in there, it goes back to close to 20 years. So it's kind of a space I enjoy, and one where, you know, I think our conviction is it's important. It's driven by innovation. It's very complex, which intellectually I find to be stimulating. It's important in terms of solving problems. And if you do it well, there's ability to do what we're supposed to do, which is create value and return, you know, returns to our investors. Also on the faculty of UC Berkeley in the MBA program, where I try and save aspiring entrepreneurs from a classical education and embrace them in the real world. I've got a team of venture partners on the Allegiance side. These are folks that are all a part of the real world in terms of they all have full-time jobs, but they're all part of, you know, if you will, our brain trust. You know, a lot of them have a lot of history with us. Jeff Williams is the Senior Vice President at FireEye. I was actually involved in bringing Jeff into a company called Iron Port Systems about 10 years ago. Jeff's one of our venture partners. Joe Levy, I was on the phone on the way down here, is a CTO of Sophos, which is getting ready to go public. Nawaf Batar, another one of the Iron Port Mafia, today is the Senior Vice President at VMware. Tom Gillis, another one of the Iron Port Mafia. I've backed Tom three times over the years. Tom runs a company called Bracket Computing. Today, previously ran the security business at Cisco. Todd Rowe runs the small and medium-sized business at Google. And Jean-Louis Gasset and I have had many twists and turns in our collective career going back about 30 years. So I originally built all the Apple technology, Apple Unix technology, and Jean-Louis was the president of Apple Products at that point in time. Got close to going to work at Apple to run marketing, but Jean-Louis and I had very different views at that point in time of what Apple should be. His view was more focused towards retail. I was focused, as you would expect, as a systems guy, towards systems. One of our predecessor funds then backed Jean-Louis when he started a company called B. And then after B, Jean-Louis joined us as a partner, and today is a venture partner. So we have a long history together. Some of the cyber investments, just pulling out seven recent ones, to give you a flavor. Bracket Computing is basically software-defined data center. So how do you walk into the heart of the beast, the enterprise data center, and virtualize that environment in an open and semi-closed environment? Security is a core element of that offering. Shape security, bot wall defenses, something that very interesting serial entrepreneurial team there. Area 1, ex-NSA guys, doing a lot of cyber threat intelligence. Moki Mobility, secure mobile application platforms. Synac, more NSA, DNA, basically white hat hackers. VArmor, security, software-defined firewalls, basically, virtualized environments. And most recently, E8 Security, which is data analytics for inside the perimeter. We have another one that we'll announce in the next couple weeks, which is insider threat behavior, and we have something beyond that that comes to sort of what I would call instrumentation of data, which has broad applications in security, but also data analytics and IoT. So talk a little bit about the threat landscape. This is, I think, one of the greatest quotes that really kind of sums up the space. Keith Alexander, back in 2012, gave a sort of a seminal talk, which really put cybersecurity onto the forefront of the modern business discussion. But he described cybercrime as the greatest transfer of wealth in the history of mankind. You stop and think about it. Okay, well, that's a big idea. And what he was really talking about, I mean, there's the elements of criminal activity, which we'll talk about. But in this particular case, what he was focusing on was the theft of intellectual property. And that has pretty broad-reaching implications, which we'll talk about as we kind of walk through the conversation. But it really frames what's going on in cybersecurity, I think, in a very interesting way. If you look at the world that we exist in today, basically the global economy runs on a digital substrate. Everything is interconnected. Things move and happen at the speed of light, and all information is connected with that network. The architecture upon which this digital substrate is built basically dates back about 40 years ago, where the definition of security was, did you turn the lights off and lock the data center? You know, communications was dial-up at best, 300 baud on a really good day. You know, you did not have the level of interconnectivity, you did not have the level of access, you didn't have the level of velocity. But we're living with that infrastructure today, you know, in this very interconnected, high-speed, access to data world, and there are all sorts of gaps and vulnerabilities, which is the entry point for this malevolent behavior that we see in cybersecurity and in hacking. So, if you look at the threat landscape, just talk a little bit about the digital economy. When we think about how do we deal with this, we view the world in two, you know, orbs, if you want. One is protecting the legacy. How do you go back to that 40-year-old architecture, identify the gaps, the holes, the weaknesses, and plug them? You know, Band-Aids. Don't mean to be dismissive of Band-Aids. They're critical. You know, a cut can get infected and could lead to the loss of a limb, so let's not dismiss Band-Aids. It's important stuff. The other side, you know, equally interesting, but sometimes with greater potential application, is securing the future. It's how do you find inflection points in the development of markets, particularly in the evolution of new platforms, where you can envision security as a design criteria for whatever it is you're doing. I used to talk about, if you look at innovation, there were three core technologies that determined where you could innovate. It was the capability from a communication standpoint, a storage standpoint, and a computational or CPU standpoint. Those three core building blocks determined what you could do and how cost-effective you could do it and how big the market applicability would be. We just call those the three legs of innovation. I believe going back a number of years ago, security became the fourth leg of the stool of innovation. And it is a criteria today in any system you're deploying, any application you're building, any network that you're constructing, security is a design criteria. And in fact, until the issues around security are addressed, in many cases, you should not deploy. It's gotten to that point. And that requires sort of a rethinking, if you will, of how you approach security, how you approach application development, deploying new services. You know, if you think about cybersecurity, for many years, cybersecurity, if you talk about board level conversations, it would be, that's the IT guys. They deal with cybersecurity. And we'll talk about some examples here in a few minutes that have really kind of taken cybersecurity out of the domain of that's an IT issue to know it's an enterprise risk issue, which totally turns the entire discussion upside down. And it brings you back to this conclusion of whenever you're doing things that involves ones and zeros moving at the speed of light with access, unlimited access to data, you better really think about the integrity and the security of those networks and of that data and the applications that access it. So we look at security in those two domains. And you know, both are important. One is about how do you take care of this massive infrastructure that's not gonna go away overnight. There actually are applications that were built on a language called COBOL that was kind of in vogue when I was in college that are still running in large government shops. So that legacy has a very, very long tail. And we'll continue to have a tail for a long time. So we have to secure the legacy. But then we have to envision a much more secure future going forward. Bad actors, you know, there's three categories of folks. It's probably not new to any of you. The criminals, highly organized crime. You know, a lot of this comes out of Russia and Eastern Europe, where there is just a phenomenal wealth of very intellectually gifted talent that doesn't have enough to do. And so it finds a way to deploy those that expertise. And you know, organized criminal activity turns out to be pretty rewarding. You know, it can be financial and intellectual property theft characteristics. You know, smart, highly motivated. One of the things you'll find, the common denominator, when you look at the hacker community, hacker in a pejorative sense in this particular case, is that they're just as smart as the good guys. They are as motivated, if not more motivated, and better compensated. So, you know, if you look at things from an amoral perspective, you got a skill set. What are you gonna do with that skill set? You know, the dark side of the coin can be pretty attractive to people that are driven intellectually. Some people are driven financially, but a lot of people are kind of driven by intellectual curiosity, interestingly enough. You have the hacktivists, the politically oriented group. Rogue actors are small informal groups who use some anonymous Syrian army, ISIS here. Smart, highly motivated. A common denominator, you know, appears to be emerging. Then there's the state actors. You know, at last count, there are 130 plus identified state actors, government-sponsored initiatives, you know, the big four, China, Russia, Israel, and the US. You know, the political motivations, intelligence gathering. There's a commercial, which is theft of intellectual property in particular. Military motivation, compromise of critical infrastructure in an adversarial environment. And characteristics, again, smart with near unlimited resources. So the difference here is perhaps in the sophistication of the attacks that are waged by these three groups. The state actors having that access to unlimited resources gives them the luxury of time. You know, that the smaller groups, the hacktivists or criminals, don't have as much luxury of time. They need to see a more immediate return on time invested. The state actors, not unusual, you know, to see a campaign developed over a couple of years, to be inside of a network for a year collecting information. You know, typically the criminal elements, you know, want to get in and want to get out with whatever the payday is. The hacktivists just want to see mayhem and want to see it as quickly as possible. State actors much more patient. Yeah, I missed one point there. The really important point at the bottom is that the battle is asymmetric. You know, in an asymmetric environment, advantage, bad guys. So the bad guys only have to be right every once in a while. Good guys have to be right every time. You know, and given that the bad guys know where the good guys are, the good guys don't know where the bad guys are coming from, you know, it is a very, very interesting threat landscape. Two types of victims. Those that have been breached and know it, and those that have been breached and don't know it. Everyone is hacked. The operating assumption in our world is they are in your network, whether you know it or not. You go back to Aurora a few years ago when Google was penetrated. Initially, that penetration was thought to be limited to Google. When all the forensics were run over an extended period of time, that breach actually compromised 2,700 organizations. So everyone gets hacked. And if you start with that premise, you begin to think about defense and cybersecurity in a very, very different context. So we'll talk about some of these examples. Genentech, one that was not widely reported. Genentech had its networks penetrated. The entry point was a fax line. So not coming in the front door, not going after the IT infrastructure, came in through a fax line. Because a fax line is there to send and receive faxes. What's the big deal? But in a highly networked environment, once you own the wire, you own the network. In this particular case, the penetration was through a fax line. The perpetrators were Chinese. They lived inside the network for about 9 months before they were discovered. During that 9 month period of time, they liberated the results of about $8 billion worth of pharmaceutical research. And after they copied the research, began to destroy all of the original data before they were caught. So, you know, for an organization like Genentech, where the value of the enterprise really is in its intellectual property, to have that intellectual property stolen and then have it destroyed, the consequences are catastrophic. Lockheed Martin, you know, about three years ago, the Chinese unveiled their first stealth fighter. Seeing the stealth fighter, I called my friends at Lockheed and I said, I didn't realize that you had sold the F-35 to the Chinese. They said, well, we didn't. Well, theirs looks a lot like yours. Well, they stole it. So you have billions of dollars going into a research and development project, and you know, the folks at Lockheed found their networks had been compromised, and a lot of the intellectual property that they had developed at the behest of the US government was stolen and ends up somewhere else. And it's one of those make versus buy decisions on a whole different level. You know, we can invest in making it ourselves or we can liberate it, steal it. Target was a really, really interesting breach from a variety of perspectives. The breach here, again, you know, people think about the numbers of, you know, 70 plus 40 million accounts compromised. What's interesting here is that the breach came in through the HVAC system, the air conditioning system. So air conditioning systems today have microprocessors that basically control them. Those systems are attached to networks. The compromise actually took place at the HVAC contractor's location. So their network was penetrated, malware was introduced. When they took their systems to perform maintenance and diagnostics at Target, they plugged their systems into the HVAC system, introduced the malware, you know, through the HVAC system, and they owned the network. So, you know, it's not just your perimeter that needs to be defended, it's your entire ecosystem that at some level plugs in or has access to your ecosystem. If you flip to the end, everybody knows what happened, you know, from public disclosures. What was really interesting in this particular case is that the consequences to management were really sort of unparalleled. CIO loses his job. CISO loses his job. CEO loses his job. That never happened before. And going into the annual board meeting, which took place just about a year ago, there's a group called Institutional Shareholder Services. And Institutional Shareholder Services is a consulting group that basically tells shareholders how they should vote on various board resolutions. And Institutional Shareholder Services put a note out saying at the upcoming Target Board of Directors meeting, annual meeting where directors are elected or reelected, these seven directors should not be reelected. because they were asleep at the wheel when these breaches took place at Target. They did not exercise their oversight duties. That had never happened before. And it took about 90 days for people really to figure out what had happened, but it sent a shot through boardrooms around the world that all of a sudden, this is not just an IT problem. You know, this is an enterprise risk problem. Boards of directors, in addition to CEOs, can lose their job over not taking this seriously. And that really began about 9 months ago, really began this shift of awareness within the corporate boardrooms around the world of how do we get ahead of this thing. And one of the real interesting challenges, one of the really interesting opportunities, is there was no real lingua franca for the board of directors to have a conversation with their IT people about what's our situational awareness with respect to cybersecurity. I mean, they're talking at cross purposes. There's no common language. There's no frame of reference. There's no way to describe what our situational awareness. You know, if you look at it from an auditing perspective, you bring in, you know, a public accounting firm, they run an audit, there's a lingua franca. This is what it needs to look like, and you're measured against, do you do this, do you don't do this, where are the gaps, where are the holes? That doesn't exist in cybersecurity. So today you have boards that are spending a lot of time trying to figure that out. One of the things I think is kind of amusing in many cases is they give the audit committee responsibility for cybersecurity. So the folks that are really, really good with balance sheets and P&Ls and audits now are supposed to provide oversight for cybersecurity. Really? They didn't know where else to go. And so boards are grappling with this. How do we get our arms wrapped around this? You're beginning to see the emergence of the chief risk officer. So somebody at a C level in an organization who comes to understand that this is not just about what goes on at IT, this affects the rest of the business. You know, and we need to look at these issues as it affects the rest of the business and get smart about it and be able to have a dialogue with the board of directors. Most recently we talk about Office of Personnel Management, which is really pretty interesting. But Sony took things to a whole nother level. I'd say sort of the second shoe dropping in terms of the corporate environment. The penetration of their networks, you know, the North Koreans, you know, are attributed responsibility for this breach. It probably wasn't quite that simple. It was probably vulnerabilities, you know, that were initiated or revealed by an insider. The North Koreans probably hit the opening, probably followed by a lot of other people. And so you had a multi-headed, you know, penetration of that organization, basically anarchy running loose in the organization with all sorts of sensitive and embarrassing information being released, intellectual property being stolen. Again, you had a CEO who lost her job in that particular case. But it really began to see, if you look at, you know, Target being the wake-up call, Sony being the one that really got people talking about what can be done when those ones and zeros are not protected and they begin to move around in an uncontrolled fashion. If you look at data breaches, you know, compromised records, just sort of a compendium. We were looking at some data today. You know, last year there were in excess of 1.5 billion data records compromised. And by the way, that's the reported stuff. The unreported numbers are actually larger than that. This is one of those really interesting areas where people don't like to talk about the embarrassing, you know, we were breached and all sorts of sensitive and valuable information which could embarrass us or do damage to us was compromised. That began to change about 3 years ago, 4 years ago. A friend of mine was an advisor to the Senate Intel Committee and the Finance Committee and pushed through some rulemaking with the Securities and Exchange Commission that required businesses to reveal cybersecurity breaches if they were material. Of course, as you would expect in a government environment, everybody then begins to debate, well, what really is material? You know, is, you know, if I lost 100 million records, but I've got a billion records, is that material? So the lawyers get involved. But what it has led to is a much more, a forced, more open discussion of these sorts of breaches and what's happening and what the consequences are. Over the last 5 years, cyber attacks have quadrupled. And you'll see this number will be up significantly over last year. You know, most recently, this is going back a few weeks ago, a couple months ago actually, in February, you know, the hacker group, Russian Eastern European originated, that stole as much as $1 billion from banks and other financial companies worldwide since 2013. I get a kick out of, you know, the quote coming from Kaspersky Lab, because there's a lot of talk about Kaspersky and their heritage being ex-KGB, and what side of the discussion are they actually on? But they are certainly revered and acknowledged as being one of the groups out there that's very well plugged into this world. It's interesting, you know, you've got a gang of hackers, criminal gang in this case, targeting as many as 100 banks, e-payment systems, and other financial institutions in 30 countries, including the U.S., China, and European nations. So it was criminal, stealing as much as $10 million each in each raid. What you can do with ones and zeros if you're organized, you know, is phenomenal. There's never been a theft, of $1 billion outside of intellectual property in terms of actually moving cash. That took place. It was caught, actually. Started last year. It was caught earlier this year. You know, what's the cost of all of this? This is part of what creates the opportunity. Depends on who you look to. Symantec, cost of intellectual property theft to U.S. companies, $250 billion annually. Many people that I talk to would say that is a conservative figure. Global cybercrime, $114 billion. Interesting enough, that number goes to 388 when you combine with downtime, the remediation costs, and the consequences in an organization. McAfee estimates $1 trillion spent globally on remediation in 2011. That's a big number. That's a real big number. 75 million unique pieces of malware in their database. We could talk a little bit more about how malware operates and why that number is so large. Industry numbers, you know, 2014, 1,500 breaches led to 1 billion compromised records. I referenced that earlier. Nader, number of data breaches increased 49% in 2014. Expect to see the same thing again this year. So this is a growth industry, you know, with a lot of money attached to it, both on the consequence and the cost side, as well as the side for protecting against these types of threats. As a result, cyber budgets are responding. One of the reasons as a venture capitalist, I really like this space. The customers are responding to the threats, the cost of the threats, the perceived damage of a threat, and are increasing their budgets for solutions. And so what you see is a nice up and to the right curve that starts with a big number, and the number just gets bigger every year. Anecdotally, I had a conversation with one bulge bracket bank back in January. I won't say who they are, but they had been breached in the fall. And I said, well, let's talk a little bit about your cybersecurity budget. And I said, the number I hear for you guys is $250 million a year. And his comment to me was, you know, that's the number that's out there. In fact, we have no budget. The budget is whatever you need to make sure this never happens again. Don't get caught with your pants down. You tell us what you need, just don't let it happen again. Because the consequences, the costs, the reputational damage is unacceptable. So if you need $300 million, you get $300 million. Just do what you need to do to make sure we don't have the problem. So from a venture capitalist, customers that have unconstrained budgets to buy technology from young startup companies providing solutions to these problems is pretty compelling. You know, for entrepreneurs who can build differentiated solutions that tackle some of these challenges and deliver value to those customers in a way that's compelling and scalable, that's pretty attractive. So, you know, I would love to tell you that our shift to cybersecurity as an investment focus was driven by pure intellectual curiosity. It's driven by intellectual curiosity combined with this is a big market, there's real value to be delivered, there's real value to be received, and there's an opportunity to create real value for investors. So for entrepreneurs, it's one of those areas where this is not a hypothetical, if we build it, does anybody care? You know, they care in advance of you building it, they just want you to build something differentiated that takes a meaningful step towards defending their infrastructure from these threats. So cybersecurity investment environment, this market, a lot of momentum. You know, if you look at companies that have gone public in the past, FireEye was a great investment for me. You know, IPOs last year, CyberArk, Improvata, MobileIron, Varonis. This year, we've got a pretty strong pipeline. Not all of these companies will get out this year. Sophos is probably within a couple weeks of going public in London. But it's an area where, you know, there's real value from the earliest stages of startup activity through acquisition to companies that they have a broad enough solution to a broad enough problem set, actually find themselves in the public markets and being rewarded with valuations that are at the high end of the spectrum for technology companies. So market driven by innovation, the bulk of that innovation takes place in small companies. If you get it right, there's a customer with a big budget and a compelling need to spend the budget, you know, and the market will reward the entrepreneur who's able to do that with high valuations at the exit of their company. Cybersecurity innovation looking forward. I look at this, if you look at the common denominator, you look at all the areas where innovation is taking place, mobile, local, social, the transition from products to services, cloud computing, SaaS, storage going through virtualization, communication, virtualization broadly said, the common denominator is that security touches all of that. So, you know, we can look at a $35 billion storage industry and say, that's a big opportunity to drive innovation. You know, you can look at what's going on in virtualization. You can look at any one of these areas and say, in and of themselves, they're significant and they present reasonably significant opportunity for innovation and value associated with that innovation. But surrounding all of that is cybersecurity. So again, another reason why we like to operate in that space. You know, cybersecurity sounds very vertical. It's actually very horizontal. It's a layer that sits on top of that entire digital substrate that I started with upon which the global economy operates. That's big. You know, and the nature of the beast in that environment is one where that asymmetry, that innovation, both on the offensive and the defensive side, means that innovation never stops. Every day, what was relevant yesterday from a defensive standpoint, tomorrow will be outdated. You know, this is a market that's driven by innovation every day because the stakes are so high, regardless of whether you're on the offense or the defensive side of the equation. So this is not one of the situations where, you know, this is the year of cybersecurity. This battle, this conflict, this challenge is going to be with us for the foreseeable future. And maybe somewhere down the road, we come up with new technology platforms that are inherently secure by design. But there will always be vulnerabilities, and there will always be people looking for those vulnerabilities to exploit them, to extract value, whether that value is financial, whether it's intellectual, whether it's political. So, some of the things that we look at, just kind of my ongoing list, secure communications, the fact that communications on a global basis, you know, basically has evolved in a period where trust is assumed, where security is assumed. If I talk to a lot of my friends at major technology companies, they'll talk about places in the world that they visit where they take no electronic devices, period, because they are targets. And they'll travel to a country, they won't take a phone, they won't take a PC, they'll take nothing with them. These same guys go to Black Hat and they have the exact same issues. Everybody wants to see who can hack so-and-so's device. You know, it's kind of sport there. When you get outside of Black Hat and you move into some of these geographies around the world, it's not a sport. The stakes are pretty high. So a company that I invested in this space, a company called Silent Circle, which is basically secure mobile communications. If anybody knows Phil Zimmerman, PGP, you know, Phil and John Callis, who did Apple's whole disk encryption, are the two technical founders of this company. Insider threats, very interesting component. 70%+ of security breaches have an insider component attached to them. They originate on the inside. Company that we're working with there, Red Owl Analytics. Software-defined firewalls. You know, the fact that when you think about virtualization, you think about web constructs, think about cloud constructs, no longer is the traffic what we call north and south, linear. You know, it's north, south, east, west, and everything in between. So there's a fabric, if you will, and you have traffic moving in all sorts of directions. That architecture is outside of typically how security products have been deployed in line, because the lines are no longer straight. VArmor, good example of a company there. Something we began looking at a couple of years ago, genetic approaches to malware detection. We start borrowing from other domains of how can you detect malware that you've never seen before. You know, people talk today a lot about APTs, advanced persistent threats. FireEye's kind of built its reputation in the world of APT efficacy. What's interesting when you look at malware is 99.99% of all malware is derivative. It's derived from previous versions of malware. You know, that 0.001%, those are the truly unique pieces of malware. By the way, those are usually developed by state-sponsored actors because they have unlimited resources to develop that. Developing malware is very, very expensive. Developing a totally unique from scratch malware strain, estimated to be a $75 to $100 million exercise. This is complex stuff. So there are very few sponsors that can commit that kind of resource to development of malware. So what you find is the rest of the world basically goes
to the malware shopping center, happens to exist on the dark web, where you can buy just about anything you want.
You want to buy malware to breach a bank. What bank would you like to breach? You know, here's the exploit kit for Wells Fargo. Would you like customer support with that? No kidding. You know, you can contract for customer support. There actually now are, you know, breach as a service where we will operate a botnet for you and you will pay per record compromise at the institution of your choice. Highly sophisticated. Everything we talk about is being innovated in the legitimate domain of technology. It's all been applied. All those business models have all been applied to the dark web and to the world of cybersecurity adversaries. So very, very sophisticated. What was interesting about this, there's a little company called Cyactive, which was the first company I looked at in this space. They were actually acquired by PayPal early this year for about $70 million. They understood that most malware is derived. So the question that we posed and that they worked on, this was actually an Israeli team, was can you take a piece of malware and can you basically metastasize it? And see as it derives, you know, what continues to be, you know, valid or viable, and what strains would die off. Metastasize it 30,000 times, then go out and take samples and build a sensor, so that you can embed those lightweight sensors in a network and see things that have never been seen before for the first time because you recognize that they were derived from something which is known bad malware. You know, so very interesting model. There's actually a couple research projects in the U.S. sponsored by U.S. research labs that are operating in that same space. So this is where you start to, you know, I mean, when you talk about innovation, this is just wild stuff. You know, it's basically totally unscripted. Security is a service, an area that we think is really important. You know, very large organizations have the resources and the expertise to stand up their own capabilities. But what about all the SMBs? You know, increasingly when you begin automating these attacks, small businesses become viable targets because if you automate the attack, you can roll them all together and you can get scale. These organizations don't have the resources, they don't have the skills, they don't have the budget to stand up their own capabilities. Yet they have those same exposures, maybe at a different level, but they have exposures. So we think increasingly that there's a scale and scope of security which actually deployed as a service to protect those small businesses. Network instrumentation. Now, this gets sort of to the instrument, the infrastructure side. This is an area where there's been a lot of opinions, you know, over time. I'm an advocate of if you want to know what's going on in a network, you have to instrument the network. That means endpoints. It means a lot of other things. For a long time, you know, what you would hear from people is, I don't want another sensor on an endpoint. They're driving me nuts. I'm just going to do it all with analytics. Well, that's great. You know, but what are the analytic tools going to analyze? You know, you're only as good as the data you collect. And if you don't collect the data, you've got nothing to analyze. So there's been a shift back over the last, probably just the last 18 months. All of a sudden people say, okay, I get it. You have to instrument the network. You've got to be able to collect and monitor what's going on in the network. Really cool company in this space, company called Carbon Black, which is part of Bit9. Yeah.
Army of security experts in my company. Look at all these various.
Well, you know, and this is just like my shopping list from last year, right? I spent a lot. I kind of, you know, the dark side of what I do, right? Is like, well, if I was an evil bastard, what would I try and do? You know, it becomes my list of solutions to look for. You know, people talk to us, you got a lot of NSA guys in your portfolio companies. Doesn't that concern you? I said, why would it concern me? Well, it's like NSA guys. I said, look, the National Security Agency is without a doubt the greatest postgraduate school in cybersecurity on the planet. You know, government funded. And there are others that are very good outside the US, but the NSA is one which is less malevolent than perhaps others. when you get to cybersecurity, my point is, I don't want guys that are approaching this from an intellectual point of view. I want teams of engineers that have stood on the wall and gone toe-to-toe with the best and the baddest in the world. There is no substitute for that experience. You know, I want that experience inside of our companies envisioning, because they've been on the other side, how are they going to defend these networks? So, yes, sir.
So you're describing a scenario of escalation, and you have your head against the wall, somebody comes in and builds a better wall, or adds to the wall, and then
you're
kind of anything. And, you know, the fact that anybody puts stuff on the cloud is kind of...
Well, that's the gating item of cloud deployment, the security, right?
But the real issue, though, is the standardization of software and components and hardware, which some of which is at risk anyway, because governments
right.
mess with the security algorithms, the wires, and the like. Wouldn't it make more sense to have private clouds, less standardized within a company?
Right.
Technology, for the same reason that, you know, Windows is attacked all the time and Apple for a long time.
Right.
Their OS wasn't attacked as much because it wasn't as big a target.
Right.
Not because it was safer.
Yeah.
So if we had variations in hardware and technology, there would be less of this that you could do.
Look, you know, whenever you know, standardization, you know, I mean, look, you know, the evolution of technology evolution, right? Innovation. You know, when it's successful, leads to emulation, you know, which over time leads to standardization, which over time leads to commoditization. Okay, that's the value cycle. And when you get to that standardized and commoditized environment, you know, the more standardized, the more commoditized, the bigger the bullseye. You know, because now once you discover a vulnerability, the applicability of that vulnerability in a largely standardized environment, it's just, you know, it's a target-rich environment. So your point is right. When I sat down and talked with some of the guys that built some of the very first transaction processing networks behind ATMs, and said, so when you guys were building these networks, you know, I mean, it used to be you'd walk into a bank and the bank would have its system and you'd see a teller and, you know, the teller probably knew you, or if they didn't, they'd ask for 17 forms of identification. All of a sudden, you're going to put a teller, you know, that can't ask those questions out on the street. How do you secure that? And their reaction was, we built everything from the ground up to be totally proprietary and totally closed, down to the hardware. That's what we did to be able to secure those networks and to have a level of trust in the integrity of those networks. Now you fast forward today, and we all think open source is just a wonderful idea. Right, because I can grab all these bits and pieces and I can put them together and look how much time I'll save and look how much more productive I will be. And that all works really, really well until you get to these questions of security. And when you pick up open source, you inherently inherit all of the vulnerabilities in that open source stack of code, nature of the beast. So yeah, there's a lot of productivity gains. You know, people talk about the cloud. Oh my goodness. I don't need all that infrastructure I once needed. Comes at a cost. Well, the cost is, you know, what we're trading in terms of productivity, lower development costs, are now switching over to the domain of security. So if you want to think about it from an intellectual point of view, it's really interesting that all of those productivity gains on the development side and the deployment side, a lot of the money that went into that development world has now been transferred over to, we have to spend it on security. You know, again, why do I invest in security? Because I've run the math. The numbers are significant. Yes, sir.
This is a general question. Now, we were at the time before the pre-cloud, there was a private network. Everything was just security networks were pretty stringent. It's just very cumbersome to work with.
Right.
Very irritating. And with the cloud, I do feel a lot more liberated.
So does your data. Well, you know, look, security comes at a cost, right? And one of the really interesting things about it, you know, there are some very, very simple things that people talk about that individuals can do to significantly reduce their exposure to identity theft and having their networks. You know, it's passwords that aren't common, you know, that don't have your birth date in it and your name. You know, and yet how many people set their password to 123456? You know, I mean, stuff when you automate a botnet attack against that, you're through it in a second. And so it's cumbersome, and a lot of people don't do it because it is cumbersome, but when you don't take those steps, again, you're just putting an open for business side on your proprietary systems and proprietary network. Now, the challenge from an innovation standpoint is how do we make security easier? How do we make it more transparent? How do we make it more easily accessible in a way that doesn't put an open for business sign to hackers on the infrastructure? And that's an area for tremendous innovation, you know, really promising. Data information assurance. This is an area, there's a really interesting little company called Onyara. If anybody follows Apache, the NSA did a code drop to Apache called NiFi. Onyara, the guys that developed NiFi at the National Security Agency. These are not spooky guys, these are really good IT guys. But the problem they had is how do you take massive amounts of information and manage it and control it, establish the provenance of that information, and give you controls over the data. I would call it data instrumentation. That's a big issue in security. It's a big issue in data analytics. It will become a huge issue in Internet of Things, where you have massive sensor networks collecting massive amounts of information, feeding it at line speed. How do you manage that? I sat down with a friend of mine who's on the board of a big financial information services company. And all of their entire business model is based on electronic distribution of financial information that they collect. So I was talking to her and I said, so how do you know that when somebody gets a feed from one of your companies, that the data is actually what it purports to be, that it's actually from you? And somebody has injected bad data into your network, spoofing everybody. You know, in the old days, this took place with, you know, bad guys would write a press release about, you know, so-and-so's, you know, phase two trials of some drug failed miserably, and they'd put it on a fax machine and they'd blast it all out, and the stock would tank, and it'd take about 90 minutes for people to get organized to say, no, that was bogus. That actually didn't happen. You know, now today, what happens when things like that get inserted into networks, ones and zeros, with no provenance attached to them, and it happens at the speed of light, and it feeds automated trading systems that can't be stopped? Data provenance becomes a big issue. Onyara operates in that space. Pretty interesting stuff. Internal threat detection and remediation, E8 in our particular portfolio. Ravi Devreddy was the head of security analytics at Visa International. Again, a guy who's built a system in a live fire environment, stood up against the bad guys and won. That expertise is really invaluable for us. One of the interesting things, area that people are talking about today, is automated response systems in security, or what I call autonomic defense. You know, if you go back and you talk about what happened at Target, Target had installed FireEye. And the FireEye system was going off left and right with, you know, sort of, to date myself, sort of messages of warning Will Robinson. You know, it's like something bad is going on. It's really bad. You need to pay attention. But the threats were valid. The information was valid, but they were not actionable. And so you get overloaded with all this information that something bad is going on, but you don't know what to do with it. And so the response was, turn that damn thing off. I can't concentrate. You know, so it's telling you the world's going to hell, right? And the response is, I can't deal with it. Turn it off. Now, that's not picking on any one particular company, but it's, you know, things are moving at a velocity where when an attack begins to develop, the velocity of notifications, you know, goes up, you know, with the speed of data being transferred. And you have the false positive problems, which one are real, which ones aren't real, which ones are more important than the others. Humans sitting at terminals cannot process at that speed. So we need autonomic defense systems to be able to collect that threat intelligence, prioritize, you know, and automate the response to as much of it as possible, so the human analysts are left to deal with the stuff that is most unique, as opposed to, there's a needle in the haystack. That's great. You know, there's a needle in the haystack, or the needle's in that corner of the haystack, much more useful. So that's an area we're going to see a lot of innovation. You know, Phantom Cyber is doing some pretty interesting stuff there. SCADA embedded systems. You know, so you hear about this in the press. People talk about this all the time. You know, these are networks that were designed just to function. You know, make sure the electricity moves from point A to point B. Make sure the water flows. Make sure the gas pipeline works. The design criteria was it should function reliably. Nobody thought of it as a target from a cyber point of view. They're not hardened. They're not secure. In many cases, if you look at utility companies, nobody even knows how the damn thing works. And it's like, don't touch it because the guy that built it retired 20 years ago. You know, heaven forbid. And so you've got this critical infrastructure, again, supporting that global economy, that digital substrate that is totally vulnerable to people that may not have your best interests at heart, that's broadly in the open. You know, big opportunity, big challenge. Internet of Things, kind of an extension of that, as I call it, chaos theory. You know, what happens when you have 50 billion devices connected to an internet, intranet, some combination of the above. I actually don't like Internet of Things. That's a consumer-oriented. I was with a guy yesterday, I said, why don't we call it the Intranet of Things, which I think is actually, in an enterprise environment, is a much more apt description. But every one of those endpoints is a threat vector. You know, and you've got them out there. They need to be cheap because there's lots of them, which means they have limited capability, and every one of them is a point of vulnerability. You know, what brought down XYZ Corporation? You know, somebody fried the refrigerator in the lounge. I mean, it really, you know, it goes back to the HVAC system at Target. You know, if you've got a smart refrigerator, you know, if that's on a network, that's a point of vulnerability. So you've got this massive explosion of devices that are connected. Each one represents a potential threat vector. You know, fascinating problem. And then organic security. This is a concept in terms of, as we envision new systems, how do we build things that are inherently more secure by design, where security is part of the substrate, part of the fabric. It's inherently secure. Don't know what that means yet. It's just a concept of how do we get ahead of these things. You know, I spent a lot of time talking about encryption. I've written that, you know, it's about the data, stupid. Why wouldn't you encrypt? You know, if you think about security, we think about identification, you know, defense, remediation. See the bad guys coming as far out as you can. Put the walls up as high as you can to protect. Once they get inside, how fast can you identify and remediate? When all else fails, what's the target? It's the data, stupid. Why wouldn't you encrypt? It's not a be-all, it's not a panacea, but it goes a little bit further. But people, they get hung up on this model of, yeah, we've got this three layers of defense. Our data is secure. Well, that's been demonstrated pretty consistently that three layers of defense fails all the time, and people walk out with the data. You know, now you start talking about how do you encrypt things? You know, the implications for encrypting data, people talk about, you know, the penalty for performance reduces, you know, adds 4% overhead to the network. That's great. What does crashing the network do to overhead? You know, a little bit more expensive. But you have issues about if you start encrypting data, now you have all sorts of permission-based systems, application interfaces. You're talking about, you know, basically reworking an entire ecosystem that's dependent upon that data that assumes the data transfers, you know, in the clear. Now you start encrypting data, and there's a lot of thinking that has to go into how does that data move around, and how do you establish provenance, and how do you establish rights, and how do you establish chain of custody? Frank, it's where you go back to things like Onyara, which has a lot of that built into its data model. So, you know, it's interesting. Cybersecurity is not a thing. Cybersecurity is a category, a very, very broad category that basically touches this entire digital substrate upon which the global economy operates. And there are a whole bunch of actors with various motivations that have different ways of achieving their objectives by compromising the integrity of those networks. And cybersecurity is about how do you defend that. Yes, sir.
So all of this is dependent on connectivity at some point. But these days, there are a lot of things I can do without even being connected. I can walk into a company with my cell phone and the thing that 2 years ago was Google Glasses. Everything. And there's stories I was reading the other day about Google being able to listen to your computer's phone to pick up the conversation. So even if you were to be thoroughly isolated from a network perspective, you're still subject to some type of information loss and attack due to people just walking in with various devices that are not connected, much less devices from the outside that can peer in.
Yep. No, anytime you connect to a network, it's a point of vulnerability. Some of the best cyber engineers I know do live totally off the grid. I mean, totally off the grid. And it's like, why are you guys so paranoid? It's like, you remember where we used to work? There's a reason why we're paranoid. You know, we kind of know what people are capable of doing. And so, you know, at some level, you know, this is the trade-off, right? And the trade-off operates at multiple levels. From a privacy perspective, kind of building up on your theme, you know, if you go back and you look at the license agreements, and Silent Circle did this really interesting sort of man on the street interview where they talked to people about have you looked at the license agreement for all the apps you use on your smartphone, you know, and it's usually like in 2-point font, it's like 30 pages long, you can't read it, so you go, yes, of course I accept. You know, you start reading what those licenses say, and it's basically, we reserve the right to look at all the information that you use with our app and do anything we want with it, including the ability to reach in and change things on your system if we like. And, you know, people start reading that and go, whoa, wait a minute. But you're giving people permission. We had a portfolio company that was in stealth. And they're operating in security, a very seasoned team, and they said, you know, bad guys, if we're right about what we do, if we're good at what we do, bad guys are going to come after us. So we're going to be as invisible as we possibly can, as long as we possibly can. So no phone number, no address, unmarked building, as invisible as they could possibly be. CEO would not send out board decks, wouldn't use email at all. You know, when we went to a board meeting, he'd pass out the board materials. He would collect the board materials. You weren't allowed to leave with it. Wouldn't send his presentation anywhere, you know, paranoid and legitimately so. And so the company spent a tremendous amount of time and energy to basically remain as invisible as possible. When they're interviewing to add to the team, they're using Gmail, you know, back and forth. A, because people they're recruiting, you know, don't want it going to their corporate email, and they're trying to be invisible. And all of a sudden, you find that the company pops up on Google Maps. And you go, what the hell? Well, what the hell was that Google was reading all the email and figured out where this company was located and put it on Google Maps. It's like, what? You know, and so, you know, there's an entire side of all the security stuff that's the privacy side of this. And this is where, you know, there's a lot of discussion about the NSA. I had dinner with the former general counsel of the NSA. A few months ago, and we were talking about this issue. And he said, you know, his question is, what do we need to do to restore trust, you know, in Silicon Valley? I said, it's tough. And he says, well, you know, and this is dinner the night before the conference that was done at Stanford University where the president was there, where most of the tech CEO community was missing because of schedule conflicts. The conflict was over values, it wasn't over schedule. And, you know, some of the activities that have been reported and some of the compromises of technology companies has had a pretty chilling effect, not just on those companies, but on customers around the world. And I'll tell you, it's interesting. I've had conversations outside the United States where people say, well, we're just concerned about U.S. technology because we're worried about, you know, government agencies having backdoors and collecting our information. And, you know, my response was, look, I get that. I don't think it's nearly as pervasive as you think it is. But let's assume that I'm wrong and that your paranoia is well placed. Let's look at your options. So you're going to turn to Huawei for your networking, right? Well, I said, no. You're going to go to the Russians for, no. You're going to build it yourself. Well, we don't have the X. So what are you going to do? You know, what are you going to do? And I said, so even if you're right, then you start saying, well, who's the less malevolent, you know, across, you know, all of these organizations where technology comes from? Now, if you, going back to this conversation I had with the guys at the end, so they got a really tough job, you know, and if you put yourself in their shoes for a minute, if they miss something, people are yelling at, we give you $50 billion a year, how could you possibly miss anything? We give you money to keep us safe. How did you miss something? So what comes out of that environment? We can't miss anything. How do we not miss anything? We need to know everything so we don't miss anything. Now, they have a big data problem there. How do you collect all that information and find the things that are actionable? But they try. You know, and people talk about these FISA courts. That's a pretty rigorous process. It's not a perfect process, but it's a pretty rigorous process. So they're driven by paranoia, you know, and the actions that they take in pursuit of their paranoia, you know, creates distrust and mistrust on the part of, you know, people whose information is being collected and used in ways that they didn't intend. And so at the end of the night, I said, look, the only way you're going to get through this is over time, and you're going to have to sign up for, there needs to be a rigorous public discussion about what are the rules, you know, bright lines. And it needs to be a much more public conversation than you're willing to have. When people cross over those lines, they have to go to jail. You know, not a letter was put in somebody's personnel file. It's like so-and-so went to jail for 10 years. And you're gonna have to sign up for a lot more oversight than you're comfortable with. You know, but only by doing that over time can you begin to establish that there are boundaries and conditions and trust can be reestablished. And the problem is that nobody knows how to collect that much information, parse through it in a meaningful way, extract what is most relevant, you know, and then act upon it. You know, I've had organizations where they, you know, we've had companies in deep packet inspection, right? And it said, we want to use your technology for deep packet inspection. Okay. How long do you want to save data for? How much data do you want to save? We want to save all of it. Well, for how long? Well, forever. You want to save everything forever. Yes. Why? Because, and there's a kernel of truth to this. This is because we don't know what we don't know. And something may happen that has us going back saying, where did it start? You look at some of these advanced persistent threat attacks, right? They develop over 9 months or longer. You know, it's not like the door gets open, it all comes in, finds its place in the network. Drip, drip, drip over an extended period of time, you know, penetrating a network, finding itself, and formulating an attack in an automated fashion. How do you defend against that? So you have this paranoia that drives behavior. It's why I go back to, I think some of the things around data and being able to establish provenance of data becomes very, very important, because if you could begin to tag data, you know, if you have an instrumented data model, there's a lot more useful information that helps you manage that data in an intelligent fashion. That's an interesting idea. But today, you've got data overload, and people don't know what to do with it. You know, and when it's like you go back to RSA, right? We're gonna take all the keys, and we're gonna put them in a super secure, super safe spot. And we're gonna harden that spot. And the whole world will be safe as a result of that. Yeah, until the safe gets penetrated, and then the keys to everything are out in the open. You're actually much better distributing that information all over the place. You know, but the idea when you don't know how to defend something is concentrate it all and harden around that concentration, which actually makes data much more insecure. So that's why these big data repositories are such attractive targets for people. Yes, sir?
So going back to when you were talking about giving the example of the apps.
Right.
I figure like my contacts database, my contact information, probably on 200 app company servers somewhere. So what do
consumers do there? I mean,
this is sort of the insidious part of this, right? There are popular social media applications that correct 30 to 35 pieces of information about each one of their users every day. And all of that information goes into feeds their analytics machine that tells them where to place ads, what kind of ads to place, how to optimize. You know, and when you sign that little license agreement that says, sure, you know, you agreed to all of that. Now, you don't know that you did that, but that's the stuff that's in 2-point font in 30 pages. You know, if you look at some of the things with Google, you know, the fact that they scan, you know, all of the email. You know, now their argument is, look, we have benign reasons for doing this. We want to improve your user experience. We want to make you more productive. And the more information we have, the more productive we can make you. The more information we collect, the safer we can make you. So the idea is that all of this information Yeah, and I think by and large, a lot of people have good intentions. They don't start off with bad intentions. It's just bad things happen, bad consequences happen, unintended consequences happen as a result of all of this information. Information is power being aggregated, and then it gets used or abused in ways that were never intended when it was originally collected. You know, and you know, back to your question, you know, we are willing participants in this process of giving up our privacy. You know, our company Silent Circle, the one that does, you know, secure communications devices, basically sandbox every application, you know, so that they can't talk, they can't share information. And if you want to share information, you have to explicitly say, please allow this information to be shared, as opposed to the default condition being, well, share everything with everybody. You know, it's a big kumbaya moment. So, yes, sir.
Can you talk a little bit more about, like, your challenges of, as a VC firm, of the disconnect between the incentives that you were describing, like, for if the potential entrepreneurs are any good in this industry, they won't even, like, even need your money because they can get it, like, in millions or billions if they want to. And on in the other hand, like, they will refuse to give you a pitch deck, right? They will refuse to pitch.
Well, security is a really interesting domain. You know, there's a cybersecurity community is a pretty small community from an investment perspective. You know, if you look about how many people have been operating in the space for 15 years, it's like that many. And I think if you're in that space long enough,
you know, hopefully you've developed a good reputation. With that reputation comes trust. One of the great things I love about entrepreneurs is, and I tell my class at Berkeley, I said, the great thing about entrepreneurs is they can't help but tell you what they think. They just can't help themselves. There's no filter, you know, and that's, there's good and there's bad attached with that, right? Sometimes, like, you know, you got to filter that a little bit. It may not be productive for yourself, but it also means when you talk to an entrepreneur and you say, what'd you think of that investor? Or what'd you think of that exec, or whatever, you're going to get more times out of not, you're going to get a very honest answer. And, you know, entrepreneurs, when they talk about venture capitalists, tend to be very honest. You know, one of the things when I started our firm, I was focused on, look, I'm an entrepreneur. I built a team of ex-entrepreneurs. We're going to be very entrepreneur-centric. You know, just because we manage a lot of money doesn't make us smarter than everybody else. That's a fallacy that sometimes exists within the venture community. We manage hundreds of millions of dollars, ergo, we are smarter than everyone else. That's bullshit. That's just total bullshit. If you know more than the entrepreneur, then you ought to be building the damn company. You know, what you should be able to do is use your experience as an operating executive, or maybe your experience as a venture capitalist, to identify what ideas have legs, what are the merits of the team, can you help the team become successful? And I think if you look at venture capitalists who've been successful for an extended period of time, it's those that establish a relationship of trust with entrepreneurs, that really understand their success is tied to the success of the entrepreneur, and move heaven and earth to help that entrepreneur be successful. That's really what drives this business. Money is not driven by, the industry is not driven by money. It's driven by entrepreneurial passion, you know, and commitment to success. And I tell people all the time, startups don't exist in nature. Think about that. Startups don't exist in nature. Now, a startup surviving is a function of commitment and conviction over the laws of physics. It's persist at any cost. I don't know better. You know, I will not quit. So now the flip side of that, if I put my venture hat on, and it's a really good thing, right? Because the entrepreneur's got to get up in the morning and go, no, no, laws of gravity don't apply to me. I can fly. No, I can fly. I know I can fly. And on the back side of that, there has to be just this little bit of awareness that, yeah, but I could fall too. And so maybe I ought to think about, how do I hedge my bets here a little bit? And that's where the team you build around you, it's the advisors that you build around you, maybe it's the investors you build around you, are all part of, I've got a bold, audacious vision, and I'm committed to it, but I know the path is not a straight line, and I better get some folks that can help me figure that out. I tell people, you know, building a startup is like running through a minefield in the middle of the night naked, okay? There are two ways to get through it. There is the Braille method, which has a relatively high level of attrition, or you can go get a map. You know, given a choice, go for the map. Now, the map comes in the form of experienced venture capital advisors, maybe, people that you surround yourself as an entrepreneur, operating executives, people that can help you see in a constructive way the things that are going to be challenges, the things that aren't going to go right. I guarantee you, no matter what the startup is, Ironport team was probably the best team I've ever worked with. And even there, we had a couple challenges along the way. Perfect execution, you will come off the rails at some point in time. You just will. And the question is can you anticipate it? Can you catch it before it happens? When it happens, how fast can you catch it and get back on track? And that comes to the people that you surround yourself with. Frankly, it comes to the culture that you build, where people are free to stand up and say, I'm not so sure about this. You know, and you know, if you think about it, a company doesn't exist because of a single individual, it's because of a group of individuals that come together, that have trust and respect, that share a goal and a vision, and can work together as a team. You know, I think technology is really important, I think innovation is really important. Culture is what wins at the end of the day. It's people that have each other's backs, that will pick each other up when they need to be picked up, that will leverage each other, that don't have too much pride over, I can't admit that I don't know that, or I can't admit that I need help, that are all so tied together, you know, the band of brothers phenomena, if you will, that nobody will stop because they don't want to let everybody else down. At the same time, they share openly. I remember coming out of an Ironport board meeting once upon a time, talking with Tom Gillis. And Tom said, you must come to our board meetings and think like we're just the most harmonious group of people you've ever seen. I said, well, you know, you guys are all pretty on the same page all the time. And he says, let me tell you how it really works. And this is the second time I had backed Tom. And he said, we've got a culture. Scott Weiss was the CEO of Ironport, and Scott's now a partner at Andreessen Horowitz. And Scott really focused on building culture. And that company, as it got larger, the culture just got stronger. A lot of times you start with a strong culture, and as you grow, it diminishes. This one, we went from 12 people to 450 people, and the culture just kept getting stronger, which was amazing. And it wasn't accidental. It was because of massive investment in getting the culture right. But Tom talks, we go to our exec staff meetings, and there's like a rule. And the rule is, don't walk out without saying everything that's on your mind. You don't walk out with any reservations. You don't walk out without saying what was on your mind. And I said, well, how does that work? He said, well, and these were all super A-plus type personalities. And he says, well, you know, the rule kind of is you can walk in and you can say anything about somebody's idea. He says, you can say, that's the dumbest effing thing I've ever heard. He said, as long as you end it with dude, it's all good. He says, that's the dumbest effing idea I've ever heard, dude. And then it's like all in the family. It's all cool. So it's not personal, you know? And so they built this culture. But it was all about getting, you know, kind of adversaries. It was all about getting to the best possible idea in a way that nobody walked out with their feelings hurt, or wishing they had said something, or feeling alienated, and building a culture around it. So that's a bit of a tangent from your point. But I think, you know, we talk about technology, we talk about capitalization. I'm like, culture, 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 culture. Culture is what wins. Culture is an unfair competitive advantage. Now, as it relates to the venture community, the venture community is not a singular thing. It's made up of individuals who all have their own styles, their own philosophies, their own personalities, their own strengths, their own weaknesses. And, you know, not all venture capitalists are created equal. I started a firm because I thought there was a need and an opportunity to do something different. You know, in our portfolio today, I think we've got four teams, where it's the third or fourth time we've worked together over the last 20 years. So for me, that's a pretty good indicator that, you know, most of our venture partners are ex-operating executives of ours. It's like we're doing something where we're connecting with people. But I think one of the criticisms I have of entrepreneurs is they don't spend enough time picking their partners carefully. You know, it's when you come off the rails, same as adding out your team. Will people be part of the problem or will they be part of the solution? Take the time to find out. It goes back to entrepreneurs can't help but tell you the truth. If you're looking at three venture capital firms, by the way, it's not the firm, it's the individual at the firm. You know, the firm is a name on a wall. The name on the wall is not coming to your board meeting. The name on the wall may be writing the check, but you're really engaging with a partner. pick wisely, to borrow from, you know, Indiana Jones, because the consequences of getting it wrong can be very, very expensive. So do your research. You know, talk to entrepreneurs that have worked with that venture capitalist. What did they think? Get tangible examples of what were they good at, what were they not good at? What should I expect? How do I engage them? How do I get the most out of them? You know, the work from a venture capital perspective and from an entrepreneur's perspective, the work is not done at board meetings. You know, for me, board meetings, that's a checkpoint restart. Are we all on the same page? That's the moment of synchronization. The real work is done in between the board meetings. You know, that's when you want an investor to roll up their sleeves and get into the trenches with you and help you build the company. And take an active role, not a passive role, not a, you know, gee, John Doakes is in my Rolodex. Send John a note and tell him I sent you. Much different than I'll call John and tell him what we're doing here and get the conversation set up. The problem with a lot of venture guys is they don't have time. And they don't have time either because they don't want to allocate the time or because they're trying to do too many things. And, you know, time is a finite, you know, 168 hours a week. You know, they got to sleep a certain number. How many do they have left? And, you know, the more companies they're working with divided by number of hours, the less time they have for you. So you think about how many portfolio companies are they working with? Do they have the time? Do they have the inclination? Do they have a skill set that helps me mitigate some of the risks that I'm dealing with? Let me check that against other entrepreneurs that they've worked with. Entrepreneurs don't spend enough time doing that due diligence. Now, peace. You know, at the end of the day, it's get funded. You know, and the conversation I'm advocating is where you have a luxury of investors to choose from. Hopefully you'll all be there, and then this applies. If you don't have that luxury and there's, you know, and there's one person that wants to invest and that's all you got, and they look pretty damn good to you right now. But even then, I'd take the time to go through that process because then you know what to expect, you know, when things get complicated. You can try and get ahead of it a little bit. But entrepreneurs don't spend enough time evaluating their investors. Everybody's money spends the same. There's no difference. It's the people that come attached with the money that can be an asset or a liability for an entrepreneur. And I call it relevant capital. All the capital is the same. Question is the relevance. What skills, what soft skills do they bring with the capital that help you improve your probability of success? So, yes, sir.
So, you know, we should talk more later, because I actually I was the first engineer for Fire. So I was with Ashar for 6 months together. I mean, I was there actually for 3 years, but for the first 3-6 months, I was actually with Ashar, just both of us.
Mm-hmm.
Anyways, so I'm building a startup right now, and what I found is that it's actually very hard. So usually when you go to a VC, they're going to ask you, are you a consumer company or are you going to be an enterprise company, right? And generally for security, it's going to be enterprise.
Right.
It's almost always given. Problem with enterprise is the sales cycle is really long.
Right.
And as a startup, you're kind of at a disadvantage in the sense that they basically said, well, you're too small, or you don't have traction, or who are your other customers? And generally, right. You know, I'll be lucky to have a pilot at least.
Right.
So how do I deal with that?
Well, you know, it's totally fair. I mean, the challenges were, the big value for an enterprise, for a startup, is the enterprise market in most cases. Because you look at the lifetime value of one of those customers, it's a significant number, and investors kind of get that. The problem is getting to that level. How do you get the first POC? How do you get the first five POCs? When you go to build an enterprise sales organization, it consumes a massive amount of capital. If your company is going to be acquired by another large company, they don't value the sales organization. So you spend all this money building something that they don't value when you go to sell the company. So you got to think through all that very carefully. I think one of the interesting things I find in security is that enterprises, not all, but there are enterprises that are more willing to engage with a startup than in a lot of other areas. If you go back to like 1998, 1999, corporations where there's this web thing and it's gonna change our world and we're not sure if it's a good thing or a bad thing and it's all coming out of Silicon Valley and we need to go embrace all these young little companies. And when the whole thing blew up, they were like, oh my God, those damn startup companies, we'll never do that again. Risk, 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 risk. And that kind of mentality persisted for a long time. Security is a little bit different. And I find with, J.P. Morgan would be an example, Blackstone would be an example, guys that I deal with that are very, very technical, and they understand what they're looking for is cutting edge innovation. And they understand that that cutting edge innovation is not coming from a large established security provider, it's coming from a startup. And so they look at that startup on a risk adjusted basis. Yeah, there's risk. It's small, it's under resourced, undercapitalized, but it's got cutting edge innovation. So on a risk adjusted basis, where do I engage? And it'll come down to the value proposition of that startup. You know, is the value, is the potential of the solution, does it outweigh the risks of engaging with a young company? You look for those customers. And they're not all that way. But security is one of those areas where people realize the solutions lie in the innovation, and the innovation is coming from young companies. And you'll find that there are companies out there that recognize that and willingly engage with a startup, because the risk of getting it wrong, you know, in terms of not solving a problem, is greater than the risk of a young company failing. It's all about risk. And so you have to pick very, very carefully. But they're out there. A lot of other areas you don't find that. It's just show me the big stable company.
Do you normally find vertical first, or generally just go wherever actually the
risk? Well, I think, you know, now you come to about use cases, right? And where do you have a solution that's going to find the greatest resonance in the market? I mean, you may look at certain cybersecurity, technologies. Say, well, it's got these six verticals. Okay, which one's the low-hanging fruit? Which one has the most pain? And as a result of having the most pain, is most likely to take a risk on a young company because the payoff is greater. So, yes, sir. Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, there's, yeah. Yeah, we have a company. I think that area is pretty well served today. We have a company called Synac in our portfolio, which is one of the good companies there. There are a number of them out there. Again, I'm looking more in terms of what's the next set of problems I'm thinking about. I mean, you know, in data, encrypting data in motion is not on my list. It's actually always in the back of my head. It's like, how do we institutionally secure data? It's a security problem, but it's actually a bigger problem than just security. So for me, that list is not inclusive. There's a lot of other things that people are doing. I mean, people today say, well, malware is, antivirus is so passe. It's all about APTs. Okay, that doesn't mean viruses and malware have gone away. They're still there. There are databases with in excess of a billion identified pieces of malware. You know, that still exists. So, you know, sometimes a little bit of our technical arrogance kind of moves on to what is the next big hairy problem. It doesn't mean that all the past things are no longer relevant. So, you know, companies like Kaspersky's got a really nice business solving those problems. Bitdefender, a really cool technology company that most people don't know about, really good at solving those problems. But for us, we're kind of looking at what's the next wave of problems that we think need to be dealt with. And that's where that list comes from.
My question was, am I in the right industry, or should I change my focus?
Well, there's a lot of energy that goes into software testing and validation for vulnerabilities. That's valuable. I mean, again, we have to think about this. This is about building an entire ecosystem that looks at every activity, every line of code, from a perspective of security, which means there's plenty of room. So you're in an area where there's a lot of interest. The question is, how do you got to cut through the noise, because there are a fair number of people out there working in that space. But you know, just because a space is noisy, like data analytics, there's a dozen companies in data analytics applied to security. Why did I invest in the one that I did? Because 11 of them, I couldn't figure out what was different. You know, it was all, well, we're going to collect threat intelligence and run it against data, a data model with some machine learning, and we're going to get better at identifying threats and more. And I was like, Ravi Devreddy, at Visa, who started EA, says, let me tell you what we did at Visa. Big bullseye on our back. And let me tell you what we learned. Let me tell you how we responded to what we learned and how we're generalizing all those learnings to build a commercial product. Ravi had stood on the wall and battled with the bad guys. You know, that's the difference between somebody who's engaged with an adversary and has learned, as opposed to somebody who's approaching things from an intellectual perspective. Taking nothing away from the intellectual perspective, but this is an area where experience matters a lot.
Thank you.
And so, you know, you've got to be able to cut through the noise. And one of the things about security, there's a lot of noise. You know, 5 years ago, nobody cared about security. It's like, yeah, everybody talks about it. Nobody's ever spend money on it. You know, today the venture guys are falling all over themselves to get into security. You know, and the challenge in security from an investor's perspective, but also from an entrepreneur's perspective, is a lot of times the entrepreneur or the venture capitalists don't know the difference between a good idea and a bad idea. So they fund all sorts of nonsense because they don't know the difference. Well, for the guy in that group that actually has a differentiated idea, his life just got much more complicated because now he's knocking on the same door at JP Morgan or Citi or Goldman or whatever it is, you know, as the other 11 guys with a similar sounding message. How does he cut through the noise? That's a challenge. Yeah.
I'm going to give myself the last question of the evening.
I'll be around though, so.
One of my frustrations at Hackers and Founders is we have this amazing community of innovators, but a lot of times the great problems aren't necessarily close to the innovators. I think there's an amazing amount of great problems in large companies that startups can and should solve. What are ways to actually get those problems in front of great startups? And I think that goes to your question, which is, I have a solution with my company, but I don't necessarily have the bird's eye view of the market because I'm solving this technical problem. I would love to hear your thoughts on how to find good problems as an entrepreneur.
Well, so there are two different answers, right? One is, if you already have an idea as an entrepreneur, then it's how do you connect with the person who will value your solution? Now I'm back to my roadmap. You know, somebody who knows the customer set and has access to the customer set. You know, if you look at my venture partners, right? Between Jeff Williams at FireEye, you know, and not on my list, but John Stewart, who's the CISO of Cisco, those two guys know every customer in the world. So my ability to say, guys, we've got company XYZ, you know, y'all know what we're doing, who do we take them into? You know, gives my company a huge significant advantage. So it's that Rolodex, but it's gotta be somebody who's willing to go to work with you, right? And not just talk about it. You know, I know everybody, you know, no, that's really great. What are you gonna do to really help me? If you don't have that idea, you know, where does my list come from of things? You know, yeah, part of it's Bob sitting in a dark room going, you know, if I was a badass hacker, what would I go after? You know, okay, well, we need a solution there. You know, that's where encrypted mobile communications came from. You know, everybody, billions of devices around the world talking to each other, transmitting data all in the open, and bad guys are going, I'll have some of that, and I'll have some of that, and we need to fix that problem. The rest of it, I talk to customers a lot, you know, and I sit down and I talk about what keeps you up at night? What do you really worry about? And you've got to find forums where you can have those conversations, and you have to know how to listen. I remember, I've worked with a lot of corporations as investors, and I remember we did an exercise back in 2000. We're trying to figure out, market had crashed, and I said, we're going to figure out where we go back into the market. We're going to be very focused on where will a corporation spend money on a startup? Because they're all burnt out. They all never want to hear a startup again. We can't accept that because we're in the startup business. So that's not, we can't say, oh, that didn't work out. We're going to go home. We got to figure out. So I said, we're going to talk to CIOs and CTOs of Fortune 100 companies. And we're going to talk about their vision of the future. What are the technology requirements that allow them to achieve that vision of the future? What are the business problems they're trying to solve? What are the gaps and the holes? And we went out on, you know, I hate to say it, went out on a listening tour. We had all these relationships, we'd have these conversations. And I remember talking to the guy at Procter & Gamble, who was waxing poetic about RFID technology. And oh my, we're gonna do RFID, and we're gonna start it at the pallet level, and then we're gonna move down to the box level, and then we want printable RFID tags, and we're gonna automate our entire supply chain, we're gonna be able to track it, it's amazing. You know, it's like, you know, kind of Walmart's vision on steroids. And you start digging into that. You start saying, well, okay, that's really cool. Big vision. You could have walked away from that conversation at that point in time and said, man, RFID is big. We kept thinking, whoa, you know, what has to happen to be able to do that? Well, you know, we need to get tags down to this price. You start getting on all these economics. It's like, well, we need to get printable tags for under a penny. You know, and if you knew what questions to ask and where to drill, you walked away going, RFID, off the list. Don't want to be in that space. That's a disaster. So part of it is sitting down and talking with customers. Most of the time, customers, if you know how to approach them, will talk to you and have an open conversation. Don't press too hard, but listen. But then you have to know how to listen. You have to know what they're saying and what to take away from that that's meaningful and actionable to you. So if you just take the stuff on the surface, go get a Gartner report and read it. Not actionable for a startup. But you can get the insights from those customers. And you know, this is why in cyber, for example, it's those 10 venture investors. We know. You know, we have access to the customers. We have these conversations all the time. And so that gives us, it's not a perfect view, but it gives us a context into which to look at things. And so whether you're in cyber or any other area, you find venture capitalists that know the space or have operated in an adjacency that hopefully have picked up some knowledge about the space that will better understand your value proposition. There'll be a level of resonance there, will be more constructive in critiquing. Have you thought about this? Maybe you ought to twist it this way a little bit. And they will also have access to the customers because they've operated in that space. So that's why I think that's where venture guys can really add a lot of value, is that domain expertise. The problem in the venture community is everybody wants to be a generalist. Well, I'm doing cybersecurity, now I'm doing social media, now I'm doing sharing economy. You know, it's like, you know, my dad told me as a kid, right? Jack of all trades, master of none. You know, that is not valuable to an entrepreneur. That's not actionable for an entrepreneur. You want domain-specific advice and guidance and perspective and networks that help you reduce the inherent risk associated with your vision of I can fly. You know, who's going to help you de-risk that vision? And that's where, again, it goes back to where I don't think entrepreneurs spend enough time thinking about the you know, again, I fully admit it's a luxury that you get to choose. But even when you start the process, focus on people where there's likely to be a level of resonance, as opposed to, I've got this list of venture capitalists, and I'm going to start at A, and I'm going to go to Z, and see where I get traction. You know, who's going to understand where you're operating, has some domain knowledge where they're going to understand the context of what you're proposing? You know, it may still be a no. It'll be a faster no. And for an entrepreneur, the best thing you get, I want a yes. I'll take a fast no if I can't get a yes. You know, it's the four meetings to get to a no, because they're learning on your time. You know, great for them, not good for you, not useful for you at all. So do your work up front in terms of identifying the investors, not just the firm, the partner at the firm. Why are they relevant to you? Being able to articulate that. Don't cold call. Do not cold call. Find somebody that knows them that makes an introduction for you. I will tell you, I am guilty. I don't take cold calls. I just don't. I don't have time. So, you know, we get, I don't know, 1,500 investments a year coming at us. We make 6 to 8 investments. You know, how do I parse? It's like, who sent it to me? You know, I use the source of the referral to calibrate the veracity of the opportunity. Is it perfect? No. Does it work pretty well? Yeah. And so, you know, it's how I time manage. And so when you identify that 6 firms, that 10 firms you want to talk to, find somebody that knows them that will introduce you. So you get a little bit more of a listen as opposed to, you know, watching 15 minutes and they're looking at their watch. You know, you're gonna rely on that social tension of, gee, John sent this to me or Sally sent this to me and I've got to do right by this introduction and handle it properly, or John and Sally are not going to send me anything again. So there's a tension there that gets them kind of leaning in, wanting to hear. If it's going to be yes, that's great. If it's no, they better have 2 or 3 damn good reasons to give to John or give to Sally as to why it was no. That's why that introduction, you know, if you just came in off the street, there's no consequence, you know, and you want to create a consequence attached to that meeting so that people lean in, they pay attention. You know, the other thing I look for is, you know, my thing is, and maybe it's because I've been on the other side of the table for, you know, for quite a few years, is, you know, I try and find venture guys, which means gals and guys, just so nobody thinks I'm sexist. My whole thing is, like, when somebody spends time with us, they've invested an hour with us, they made a choice to invest that hour, send them home with something. you know, an idea, a thought, a suggestion, a phone number, an email, even if it's going nowhere, send them home with something that will hopefully improve the risks, improve something for them somewhere along the way. You know, why do you do that? Because it's a small community and everybody talks. And I've had situations where I've said no to people, but then they've referred people to me because they felt like I treated them with respect. Not enough venture guys do that. You know, and the problem is not enough venture guys have been entrepreneurs, so they don't realize how hard it is when you've got it, when you're passionate about an idea, you put the rest of your life on hold, you work 100 hours a week, you push everything to the side because you've got this passion and you can't get it out of your head. You know, and they view you and your idea as a field replaceable unit. Bullshit. You know, that takes a lot to make that level of commitment, and that demands respect. When an entrepreneur says he wants to sit down and have that conversation with you, and you've chosen to speak with that entrepreneur, you have an obligation to listen. And I think generating, you know, anything you can do that generates a small return on time invested for the entrepreneur, that's a good thing. So, I'll be around. I'll stay around.